Good afternoon, friends, and welcome to our MLS Live presentation, Virtual Planetarium Exploring Space. So excited to see our friends out there today. First, let me introduce myself. My name is Karen. I'm going to be acting as your moderator today. And all that means is I'm going to be keeping an eye out for any of your questions or observations that come in through our Q&A box. So if you are here on Zoom and want to ask a question or make an observation or answer a question that one of our planetarium educators asks, you can just put it right in the Q&A box. It should be at the bottom of your Zoom screen. Click on that and type it on in, push it on out, and I will get to as many as we can. If you are watching right now on Facebook or YouTube, we super appreciate that you are here, but we cannot field questions and comments from those platforms. And lastly, if you are looking for closed captioning, you find the CC button and choose show subtitles, those will show up at the bottom of your screen. So I think with all of that out of the way, it is time to meet our planetarium educators.
Thanks, Karen. Hi, everybody. My name is Katie. My pronouns are she and her, and today I will be your guide as we explore space, but I cannot do it alone.
Hello, everybody. My name is Talia. I also use she, her pronouns, and I am going to be your pilot this afternoon.
Awesome. Thank you. So the entire month of May is going to be dedicated to the strange, chaotic, and weird pasts of various objects in our solar system. So every week we'll have a theme within that theme. And today I figured since it's the first Tuesday in May that we would start with the sun. How did the sun form and the entire solar system? So to start talking about this, we are right now looking at a view of our entire solar system from the outside, or at least the sun and the planets. This is a program called NASA Eyes that is free to download and use. There's also a web version, I believe, if anybody's interested in playing around with it yourself. It's a very cool tool. It also highlights all of the different missions that NASA has going, current missions, past missions, even future ones as well, which is super cool. So I thought we would start here just to look at our solar system present day, right? We've got the sun right at the center, and then Mercury, Venus, Earth, and Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune. Those are the eight planets. We also have an asteroid belt sitting in between Mars and Jupiter. And we've also got, you know, many more objects out past Neptune as well, you know, the neighborhood of Pluto out there. But the solar system wasn't always this well organized. It took billions of years for the solar system to end up like this. It's about 4.5 billion years old, like between 4.5 and 4.6 billion years old. That's the estimated age of our solar system. And the planets haven't always been in this configuration, as I've already mentioned. They have kind of cleared out their orbits of any other stuff that's kind of in the way, like smaller objects. And they've actually moved around quite a bit when we look, you know, in the past billions of years. So let's take a closer look at the sun, because solar systems form from material that circles around or orbits around new stars. So I figured this would be a good starting point, and then we can talk about the different ways that the planets may have formed between rocky planets and gas giants and things like that. So our sun present day is a very average star. It's the same age as the solar system, so 4.5 to 4.6 billion years old. It is around 10,000 degrees Fahrenheit on its surface. If you were to dive into the core, you get to millions of degrees. And it's got a pretty chaotic magnetic field, which gives us lots of space weather. We have several telescopes to observe the sun. So the Parker Solar Probe is a fairly recent one that's going to study a lot of like the outer kind of atmosphere of the sun. And we also have the Solar Dynamics Observatory, which is a little bit of an older telescope that has been studying the sun. And so by studying it today and by studying other stars, we can kind of see into what the sun was like in the past. So if we can switch on over to a PowerPoint image, we can actually see the lifetime of a sun-like star. So in this particular image, all of these little dots here are stars that are like the sun. So we can't necessarily go back in time and take a picture of our sun or anything like that billions of years ago, but we can see other stars that are just like the sun at different points in their lives. And we can kind of get this full timeline of what the sun used to be like and where it's headed. So over on the left side there, you can see that's the younger side of things. And then as you approach, 10 to 11 billion years old, that's kind of nearing the end. And so the sun, for the most part, is, it doesn't change a ton. It stays, it's a main sequence star. That's its official stellar classification, G2 type star, if you want to get super technical. And then eventually, after about 4 to 5 billion years, it will start to puff up and it will expand and eventually become a red giant. So if we look back, 4.5 billion years ago, the sun may have been a little bit different, but fairly similar to kind of how it is today. And so how do stars form at all? What is the process of that like? So stars form in these giant molecular clouds where you get these kind of smaller chunks of them that collapse. So what you're looking at right now is a star birthing nebula. A nebula is just a giant cloud of gas and dust in space. There's a lot of hydrogen, a lot of helium in these particular clouds. And they're very cold and dense. So material can clump together very easily. It is thought that in our sun's molecular cloud billions of years ago, that there was potentially a supernova or something that happened that was very energetic. Maybe the passing of a really massive object that kind of set off the collapse of different parts of the molecular cloud. One of those collapses being the birth of the sun. So this material clumps together, eventually acquires so much material, something happens where this clump collapses in on itself, it causes it to collapse in on itself. Pressures and temperatures in the core of these clumps skyrocket to the point where you have atoms smashing together and fusing to form new atoms and releasing energy at the same time. So like hydrogen, for example, if you get four atoms of hydrogen kind of smashing together, they can fuse to form a helium atom, but they also release energy at the same time. And the process is a little more complicated than that. But that is the ignition of a star, is that nuclear fusion process. So I want to pause there really quick and see if any questions have come in so far.
Nothing yet, Katie, but friends, now is a great time if you have a question about anything Katie has just talked about or something maybe related you want her to touch on, now would be a great time to put it in that Q&A.
Awesome.
Just a couple seconds. Oh, there, see, you ask and people will respond with a question. So how do hydrogen atoms fuse and become helium?
Yes, so this whole process is called the proton-proton chain, I believe, where you have two helium atoms that smash together and then another helium atom kind of comes into that. And I don't honestly know the entire process. It's kind of complicated, but it's not four helium atoms just coming together and squishing together. It's a little more complicated than that, but it does result in helium atoms, which is the next heaviest element on the periodic table. And it has to release energy as well because helium's nucleus is a little heavier than hydrogen. So it has to release some energy in order to compensate for that. So that's kind of the vast majority of a star's life is fusing hydrogen into helium in the core of the star. but really high mass stars can fuse many more elements after that. So this fusion process can keep going down the periodic table. Again, a whole lot of different chains of processes in order to fuse elements into heavier ones, and eventually getting to iron, where there is not enough energy present in the core of an extremely massive star to fuse iron. And so the whole system kind of breaks down, and that's when you wind up with a supernova. That only happens with really massive stars. Average size stars like our sun, they are not going to explode near the end of their lives, but our sun is fusing hydrogen into helium in the core, and eventually may fuse into a few other elements as well, kind of nearing the end of its life in 4 to 5 billion years.
We did just have another question come in, Katie.
Yeah.
How close can a probe get to the sun to analyze it before there is a chance that it starts to melt?
That's a great question. So if we go right back to, yes, to NASA EYES, perfect, thank you. There is a Parker Solar Probe. So this is the one that I've referenced. It is a fairly recent mission. I believe it was launched in 2018. And this is going to be a spacecraft in a heliocentric orbit. So the Solar Dynamics Observatory is a telescope observing the sun around the Earth. But Parker Solar Probe is actually going to get closer to the sun than any object has ever gotten when it makes its closest approach, I believe in 2025. It does take a while to get in that close to the sun because the sun is so massive and has such a strong force of gravity that if we were to just shoot it right toward the sun, it would just, you know, fall right in essentially. So it's got to make a series of orbits and actually use Venus's gravity to kind of slow itself down as it gets closer to the sun. So that's why it's going to take a while to get there. But it's going to come within 4 million miles of the sun, which is really, really close. And you'll notice here that the orbit of the Parker Solar Probe is extremely eccentric, which means it's very oval shape or elliptical. And that's intentional because that closest approach there in its orbit will actually start to degrade the spacecraft. And so engineers, when they were designing this spacecraft and planning for this orbital trajectory, actually made it have this orbit because it will be traveling fastest when it's near the sun and slowest on the other side when it's farthest away. So it's actually not going to spend a whole lot of time in that danger zone where it's really, really close and at risk of damage. So that's kind of the precautions taken in order for Parker Solar Probe to actually carry out its mission. So yes, it can be damaged. It certainly would be if it was a lot closer to the sun for a longer period of time, but they've done a great job designing it.
I think that's it for questions right now, Katie. So if you had the next topic we're going to move on to, now's a good time.
Great. So I did want to talk a little bit about how the sun has changed over time. So we've got 4.5 billion years ago, the sun formed. There was a whole bunch of stuff orbiting around the very young sun that eventually turned into our solar system. But you know, over these billions of years, and we can even measure these today, we can see the sun changing and evolving. It goes through cycles. And so we actually have a picture of the sun over several years throughout one full solar cycle. So a solar cycle is every 11 years. And basically, it's based on the activity at the surface of the sun. So if you've ever heard of solar flares or coronal mass ejections or sunspots or anything like that, this is kind of what we're referring to. The sun peaks in this activity where we see lots and lots of sunspots every 11 years or so, and then it also declines. And so every 11 years, we also see the sun at a solar minimum. So the 11-year cycle is basically from maximum to maximum, or minimum to minimum. So this right here, this picture, 2008, I know, was the start of a solar cycle where it was actually at a solar minimum. So you'll notice that there's not a whole lot of activity going on the surface. So the left is looking in ultraviolet light and the right is actually looking in invisible light. So you can actually see the sunspots. Sunspots are an indicator that the sun is very active. The magnetic field of the sun, because stars are made of plasma, of hydrogen and helium and their plasma form, they have really chaotic magnetic fields that kind of stick out of the surface of the sun. And every so often they can snap and send out charged particles and radiation out into space, which we would call a solar flare. If it's a really, really massive explosion, it could be called a coronal mass ejection. But we also have a video of something like this happening. We can take a look at that. So this is taken by the Solar Dynamics Observatory, and you can actually see the solar flares happening on the sun. And each one of those sunspots, those little dark spots on the surface, are like the size of several Earths. So you can imagine how massive these explosions are. And that material can travel through space and eventually cause the aurora that we can see at the North and South poles here on Earth. So the sun naturally goes through cycles. It has been going through cycles for the past 4.5 billion years as it, you know, started as a little baby star and has grown into its kind of halfway point, right? And we'll continue to have these cycles until it eventually runs out of fuel and that fusion process stops in about 4.5 to 5 billion years. So that's a little bit more about the sun, but I do want to talk about how planets form, because that's super interesting as well. So we did show that clip already of stars forming and that star birthing nebula. But I want to show it again to highlight specifically what's called a protoplanetary disk, or the beginnings of a solar system. So after a brand new star forms, the cloud collapses, you get the fusion happening. There's a lot of material that's kind of in orbit around the star that eventually flattens out because of angular momentum. And that material that doesn't end up going into making the star will actually clump together to form things that you'd find in a solar system. So planets, moons, asteroids, Kuiper belt objects, you know, anything that you would find in our solar system or other solar systems comes from this cloud, essentially. So I think it takes a second, but we'll come around the corner soon and you can see an example of a protoplanetary disk. They're also called proplids for short, just because there are a whole bunch of syllables in protoplanetary disk. So it might be easier to remember that way. And as we come right around this corner, I believe we should see a small disk. I think it's hiding behind a baby star. Ah, there's one right in the center. So our solar system, as well as many other solar systems, have all formed in a protoplanetary disk about 5.5 billion years ago, around the same time the sun formed. And what's really interesting is that these disks end up, given enough time, they end up kind of separating so that certain types of material are present in certain parts of the disk. So if we think about like terrestrial planets, we can go back to NASA EYES and just look kind of at the general structure of our solar system. So those inner planets there, the terrestrial planets, all formed closer to the sun because metals, so like things like iron and nickel, aluminum, other kind of rocky compounds are all, they have a higher melting point. So they're actually able to kind of exist near the chaotic kind of hot part of the solar system. But these metals are also more rare. They're rare in the universe in general. So terrestrial or rocky planets do tend to form closer to their stars, but they're not very large. Because there's just simply not that much of those particular materials. What there is a lot of, though, are gases and ices. So as we kind of move out in the solar system, we cross what's called the frost line, or the part of the solar system where icy volatile compounds are able to exist. So like icy water, icy ammonium, methane, things like that can actually coalesce out past the frost line in the solar system. And as a star forms it, lives its whole life, it emits a lot of radiation called the solar wind and lots of charged particles. And so these kind of lighter elements are actually able to be easily influenced or pushed away. So it kind of gets pushed out into the outer solar system. It's much colder out there past the frost line. So these are the types of materials that you then get clumping together in the farther parts of the solar system. So gas giants like Jupiter, Saturn, ice giants like Uranus and Neptune that are also made of gas, but also have lots of ices in them, all formed because of these gases and ices out past the frost line. Now, it is also possible for planets to migrate. And we think that the asteroid belt in particular didn't form a terrestrial planet because of Jupiter. So the asteroid belt is made up of millions and millions of pieces of metal, essentially rock and metal. And so if you think about it, well, why didn't all of those little tiny pieces coalesce to form another terrestrial planet? Well, it turns out that it could have been Jupiter and Saturn's fault. They have so much mass and so much gravitational influence on that part of the solar system that they simply didn't allow them to coalesce, right? So there's something called orbital resonance, where things can kind of, they wind up in regular periodic gravitational influences with each other. And so basically the gravity from Jupiter and Saturn stopped any of that material from actually clumping together. And so that's why we think we have the asteroid belt. Now there is another belt out past Neptune called the Kuiper belt, which is believed to be something similar, where instead of Jupiter and Saturn that are doing the influencing, it could be Uranus and Neptune that may have been closer. And so was the Kuiper belt, much closer to the sun in the early days of the solar system. And those two very massive planets eventually kind of pushed them all the way out into the outer edges of our solar system. So there's a ton of different theories about how exactly the current configuration of the solar system came to be. And one of the other programs this month is going to be all about Jupiter's journey through the solar system to find its current place, its current orbit around the sun, because it's thought that it may have gone on quite a journey. It may have even kicked out some planets in the early solar system that we don't have anymore today. So Tali's going to be talking about all of that another day this month. So I'm going to stop there and see if any questions have come in.
It sounds like quite of Jupiter. I'll be excited to tune in and listen on what Jupiter did to those non-existent planets. We did have one question that came in regarding the metals that can resist being melted by the sun. The question is there any magnetism in any metals that could also be drawn to any magnetism in the sun, if there is any?
So there is a lot of magnetism happening in the sun. Because of the fact that the sun is made of plasma, and stars can also eventually create metals. Generally, those are very, very high mass stars, but in the cores of stars, they can absolutely create metal. But because stars are made of plasma, this is a charged version of an atom, for example. So like, instead of just regular helium gas, it is charged, it's heated. And so it has an electric charge to it. And because electric fields and electricity causes magnetism and vice versa, the sun has a very intense magnetic field that plasma can travel along. The magnetic field lines can get all twisted and turned and snap and send material out into space. And the magnetic field changes a lot because the sun doesn't all rotate at the same speed. Some parts of it rotate faster than others. This is called differential rotation. And so this is actually what causes a lot of the weird magnetic field behavior on the surface of the sun. And so every 11 years, it actually switches magnetic polarity, which is totally normal. It does this all the time. It does have some effects on the solar system, but it is very normal. And so, yes, there's a lot of magnetism happening within the sun, and it would be much stronger than any kind of metallic magnetism happening on very, very small terrestrial planets.
Well, cool. Thanks for that. That was the only question thus far. You have one more topic, or are we wrapping up?
That's all I had today. So I figure that we can maybe take one more look at our solar system. And I'll just maybe briefly tell you about what's going to happen to the sun. I've mentioned supernovas many times, a very high mass stars that will eventually kind of run out of fuel. They'll hit that fusion point where they can't fuse iron and then collapse after that. But average stars like our sun will actually get puffier over time. They'll expand, and our sun will turn into what's called a red giant star. And it will be so big that it will engulf the orbit of Mercury and potentially even Venus, putting Earth no longer in the habitable zone of our sun, but it would actually be somewhere around Saturn, maybe even Uranus, or the Uranus moon system would be more habitable than our area. So in 4.5 billion years, our sun will get bigger and then eventually just kind of shed its outer layers of gas out into space. And it will turn into a giant rainbow space bubble, which if you ever want to look them up, they're called planetary nebulas. And so that is the fate of our sun. We talked about the past a lot, so I thought I'd...
I like rainbow space bubble, though. That sounds way cooler.
Yeah, I do too.
We did have one question that hopefully we have time to answer real quick. Will any of the asteroids ever fly out of the asteroid belt?
So that can happen, depending on like if there are any kind of gravitational perturbation. Sometimes asteroids can get flung out of the asteroid belt. The solar system is fairly stable these days, but earlier on in the solar system, it was a lot more chaotic. And so that actually happened quite frequently. And a lot of the moons around the just around all of the planets. So Mars's moons, plenty of Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune moons, they are all thought to be captured from either the asteroid belt or the Kuiper belt, or a good chunk of them are, not all of them, but a lot of the ones that have really crazy orbits are captured from probably the asteroid belt or Kuiper belt.
Well, very cool. Thank you for sharing all of that with us today, Katie. And thank you, Talia, for being our pilot in the background, showing us all the amazing images. So you guys can both say goodbye to our audience today. We'll see you again next week.
Hi, everyone.
And that is the good news, friends, that we have been doing these virtual planetariums every Tuesday at 2:30. They are continuing for the foreseeable future. If you want to know what's going on sort of with any of our virtual programming, there we go. I was trying to bring up my end slide there. Hopefully you all can see that. You can check it out at mos.org/mosathome. Katie kept referencing the program that we were using today, NASA's EYES. It is a program that you can download for free and kind of explore on your own. And lastly, this is something that you enjoyed and you have the ability to do so, we always appreciate support so the museum can keep doing what we're doing. With that, I want to thank you all for coming out today. Hope you had some fun, maybe learned a few new facts, and definitely enjoy the rest of your Tuesday. Thanks, everybody. See you next time.